So today's slide is going to really focus on intramolecular forces. In order to understand intramolecular forces, it's good to have the definition of intramolecular differentiated from intermolecular forces. And one of those, the intramolecular forces, really pertains to chemical bonding, and then intermolecular forces gives rise to physical change. It's the types of electrostatic attractions between molecules that give rise to freezing and boiling. So in definition of intramolecular, you can think of intra because of the Latin prefix intra means within. So a mnemonic might be to think about intradermal injections or intramural sports that occur within the same campus. Inter comes from the Latin prefix between, and you might think about intercollegiate athletics, where schools actually compete against other schools. So this is a good example, except it's a little misleading, because intramural sports may take fairly inexperienced and less strong, if you'd say, athletes, whereas the intercollegiate athletes might be a lot stronger. This particular gentleman, 6'6 and 300 pounds. This is the exact opposite of how they apply to bonds. So when you talk about intramolecular bonds, in other words, the bond that holds hydrogen onto oxygen, that actually is very strong. It's a chemical bond that it would take 459 kilojoules per mole to break a mole of those oxygen to hydrogen bonds. In comparison, the intermolecular forces, the types of bonds that hold water to a neighboring water in, say, like an ice crystal, those are actually relatively an order of magnitude weaker. For example, in this case, it'd be 20 kilojoules per mole. So intramolecular refers to chemical bonds. Breaking and forming these bonds is a source of chemical change. There's usually 100 to thousands of kilojoules per mole involved in doing this kind of change. So if we use the analogy of water, the reaction on the left demonstrates what you could do within, say, like an electrolytic cell, which we'll study this semester in General Chemistry 2, where by applying voltage, you could split water into its individual molecules of hydrogen and oxygen. So on the right, just to kind of give you a physical demonstration, you would literally create, but it wouldn't be water, it would be hydrogen vapor and oxygen vapor. And then in intermolecular forces, the kind of bonds that hold water to its neighboring water, if you break and form those, it doesn't take much energy, anywhere from 2 to 100 kilojoules per mole. In fact, with water, the hydrogen bond holding it together is about 20 kilojoules per mole. But if you break those bonds, those physical bonds as we consider them, you basically would just turn water into steam. So once again, intramolecular deals with inside the molecules, the bonds that the chemical bonds that hold the molecule together, atom to atom. Intermolecular is how molecules hold to other molecules in physical attractions, which are what kind of defines the solid, liquid, and gaseous states of matter. So today we're going to really focus on intramolecular, the chemical bonding, and the best way to break apart the kind of bonding is location. So where you are on the periodic table really depends, determines what kind of bonding takes place. And the key line, or the crossing point, if you will, is right around aluminum, germanium, antimony, and polonium. There's a stair step, which if you're to the right of that, you're considered a non-metal. And if you're to the left of that, you're considered a metal. And anything that's actually touching that line sometimes is considered a metalloid, which means it has properties of both. So what are the properties of these two materials? And for these purposes, too, I'm going to just interject hydrogen should be slid over. Hydrogen has the location where it is on the periodic table for different reasons. It's located right above lithium, sodium, potassium because of its electron configuration. But when you talk about the type of material it is, You usually tend to slide hydrogen over there somewhere between boron and carbon. If you rated it by electronegativity, it has an electronegativity of 2.1 compared to boron's 2 and carbon's 2.5. But it is considered nonmetal for when you talk about bonding, generally speaking. Okay, so just to define metals, they're wimps. They lose their electrons very easily. Nonmetals on the right of the stair step are greedy. They're grabbing electrons. They're always reaching out trying to grab electrons, and they hold their electrons very tightly. So the three types of bonding that we're going to work on today really deal with the different combinations you can have between metals and nonmetals. Our objective is just to understand these three types of intramolecular bonding, starting with ionic. In ionic, you bind a metal, nonmetal, so you have a wimp that easily loses its electrons, and you're binding it to something that's very greedy for electrons. So in this case, we take something from the left of the table, lithium, and you bind it to something to the right, like fluorine, which is very greedy for electrons. And if we started with these as fundamental elements, you could imagine the greedy fluorine would strip an electron off of lithium. And consequently, that would make the lithium a plus one ion, and the fluorine, which has now gained an electron through reduction, it is now a minus one ion. And then these, you can imagine, would, because of their opposite charges, would be attractive and would bind together by charge. And we tend to just write this as lithium fluoride to do the charge balance on it. But once again, this is ionic bonding. And so even though you see lithium fluoride and you don't see any charge around it, what you know is that it actually is a lithium plus one ion bound to a fluoride minus one anion in the structure. Okay, just a good reminder. And sometimes we refer to the plus ions as cations, a kind of reminder that that T in there, you could think of it like a plus sign to remind you. And then the N in the anion is to remind you that it's negative. So nonmetals tend to become anions. Metals tend to become cations. These are bound by charge. You have two ions bound by charge. Just to give you a kind of perspective on the energy, the strength of a lithium fluoride, the what they call lattice energy that holds it together is about 573 kilojoules per mole. Potassium bromide has a lattice energy of 378 kilojoules per mole. If you go to the next type of bonding, it's when two nonmetals, two greedy things, get together, two thieves. So you can imagine fluorine trying to bond fluorine. Both of them would be reaching for the electrons. Okay, so in that, it's easy to just kind of draw a diagram of all the protons and the electrons in the outermost shell of these two fluorines. And then we're going to just basically split them out so you can see that one of them's, you know, one fluorine's grabbing for an electron, the other fluorine's grabbing for an electron. Consequently, they share these two electrons. So even though they're both greedy, neither one of them gets the electron free. And that's what establishes the bond, is basically the positive center reaching out and attracting to the shared electrons from both species. And that's what these lines represent. A definition for covalent bonding is bound by tightly sharing electrons. The strength of these, just to put it in perspective, once again, an order of magnitude above intermolecular bonding. Fluorine is bound together with 155 kilojoules per mole. The N2 molecule, which bonds in a very similar manner, has much greater bonding strength or bond energy of 942 kilojoules per mole. So another subcategory within covalent bonding is polar covalent bonding. And we're going to use water as an example here. The oxygen is bound to the hydrogen through covalent bonds. They both tightly share those electrons. But in this case, oxygen is a little more electronegative. So consequently, what oxygen is able to do, it is able to pull the electrons a little stronger than the hydrogen. And you'll see those electrons will actually start to shift over there. And move a little more towards the oxygen. Now, that will make the oxygen slightly electronegative. This is not a true anionic charge like in ionic bonding. And then the hydrogen, which has lost electron density, is now partially positively charged. So this gives rise to water having what's called poles. It has a negative end and a positive end, and hence the name polar covalent bonding. Unequally, yet still tightly shared, gives rise to poles or electrical charge on the overall molecule. The strength of water is not really significantly different because of the fact that it's polar. It's still defined by the strength of bonding between hydrogen and oxygen is defined as 459 kilojoules per mole. Okay, the final type of bonding is metallic. And so now we have two losers, things that easily lose electrons, metals, and you put those together. So now, once again, you can imagine that they're able to share electrons, but in this case, they don't share them tightly. So the electrons are shared, but they're shared loosely, so they can easily start moving in and out of those bonds. As this graphic depicts, the electrons can move in and out, and is sometimes described as a moving sea of electrons. Full ions are not formed, and you are sharing electrons. And so you would define this as loosely shared electrons. But the bond strength is still fairly high, 105 kilojoules per mole for lithium. Nickel has a little higher bond strength of 228 kilojoules per mole. So that's your three types of intramolecular bonding, and that is literally the what holds the molecules together.